session, we talked a lot about warfare. We went through a couple of different sections on warfare. We were finishing up the weapons section. I added just a little bit more to that. So we'll start there, and then, as I mentioned, we'll go into fortifications, and then we'll move into glimpses or how we can understand Lamanite, broader Lamanite culture through the text, even though it's written from a Nephite perspective. One thing that was Hamblin pointed out that I thought was pretty interesting, again, trying to understand the text better and learn more about the Book of Mormon through historicity was this idea of the sword, the makwahuit that we talked about last week, which was the wooden sword with the obsidian teeth are on the end. So in Alma 24:12, remember, we're going to talk about this story in particular a little bit later as well, but the anti-Nephi Lehi, the new Lamanite king, admonished his fellow converts, "Since God has taken away our stains and our swords have become bright, then let us stain our swords no more with the blood of our brethren." Hamblin made an interesting point. He said, "Wooden swords inset with rows of obsidian chips, as was the makwahuit type, would have become stained by blood soaking into the wood. Had their swords been made of metal, the metaphor would actually lose its power." Right? It's hard to stain something with metal, but you can stain wood with blood. So I thought that was again made the imagery more powerful for me. Something else that's interesting in the book, at three places we have reference to arrows that were cast or thrown. That's not normally how we would think of an arrow. A normal arrow is used with a bow. So a small arrow that's used regular bow would not fit any such phrasing. A larger arrow, quote unquote, would, the expression would make good sense. And there is such a larger arrow in Mesoamerica. The Aztec atlatl spear thrower consisted of a stick with a hooked end that was held extended in the hand with a large spear-like arrow placed above the hook. The length of the stick added to the extended arm greatly increased the force with which a heavier projectile could be thrown at the target. So the arrows that they were throwing, when we read that they throw them, would not have been, you know, the little arrows. They wouldn't have been throwing tiny arrows. They would have been throwing these bigger spear-like arrows. Scimitars in the Book of Mormon. We get this label that it's first mentioned in Enos, so about 544, and then the last mention we have it is 421 BC. Enos says, and he's speaking about his Lamanite enemies, that their skill was in the bow, and then the scimitar, and then the axe. Enos 120. When the Nephites were said to have swords during this period, the scimitar is mentioned only as a Lamanite weapon to start with. The first Nephites who were reported to use them were the Zenophites, who remember left Zarahemla to reoccupy their ancestral homeland in the land of Nephi, which was amidst the Lamanites. After the Zenophites, under their third king Limhi, fled the land of Nephi and settled in Zarahemla, scimitars came into general use by the Nephites during the first century BC. So it's pretty clear that the scimitar was a weapon that was borrowed from the Lamanite culture by the Nephites through the Zenophites as intermediaries. The scimitar now, when you more recent English would be the like this, and it's pronounced scimitar sometimes. So it's one of a number of spellings used in the 19th century for what is now the scimitar. The dictionary defines it as a saber having a curved blade with the edge on the convex side, something resembling a scimitar. So the primary distinction is between a sword and a scimitar is that the former has a curved blade. So why has this been deemed a problem? Critics have termed the presence of scimitars in the text of the Book of Mormon anachronistic because they were thought to be an Arabian sword from the post-Christian era. So you think of those big swords in Arabia that are scimitars. So it's thought to be anachronistic. The possibility has been suggested, though, that a strange double-curved weapon held in the left hand of the warrior figure in the Lultun cave relief might be considered a scimitar or scimitar. Its two blades curve in the opposite directions from the ends of a central handle. Scholars consider the object to be a weapon. Here's what we're talking about. This is a Lultun cave. What does he have on this hand, right? This is a makwahuit. That's a sword, right? You see that one actually has a sharp tip on the sides, and this is what we're talking about here. See this curved weapon that he's holding in his other hand. Lultun caves would have been carved in Book of Mormon times from people from Camino Hoyu, the Gradrabal River that that we that falls within Book of Mormon land. So the date for the figure of the low tune falls within Book of Mormon period. Moreover, the art style originated in the Pacific coastal Guatemala or southern Mexico, right, which is the lands that we're interested in. So the weapon shown in the low tune has a good chance of being one of the arms that Lamanites and Nephites were used during the central segment of the Book of Mormon history. At Camino Hoyu, even closer to home, the great ruined city in the Valley of Guatemala that we talked a lot about, Sorensen thinks is the city of Nephi, which Stella 11 shows a warrior figure holding a curved object very similar to the Lowtune portrait. Here, this is Stella 11. Can you see the hand right here and then the two curved handles on that blade? So it's believed that this Stella, it was the same weapon that it was that's portrayed in the Lowtune caves. It may have been earlier than the Lowtune, dating between 250 to 100 BC, and many some experts consider the object equivalent of double-bladed weapon in Lowtune, so they think that they're very similar. So the idea that the scimitar is anachronistic is again one of those things that as you look deeper and as we gain more knowledge actually becomes a strength, not a criticism. So that wanted to throw those last two things in terms of there's one more criticism and a little bit more context around Arrow's throne, and then move to fortifications. So the book is obviously replete with historical statements about fortifications ranging in date from about 550 BC to AD 375. From the point of view of placing the scripture in its correct external setting, the remains of fortifications will be among the most useful materials that archaeologists can use to compare the excavated record of cultural history with the scriptural record. It's a great test for the book, right? So the text says that around 75 BC, the Nephites in the land of Zarahemla engage in, quote, digging up heaps of earth round about all the cities, throughout all the land which was possessed by the Nephites. Now here's another area where some of our art gets us in trouble. Who remembers the picture of Samuel on the wall? That's a stone wall that looks to be about 50, 60 feet high from what I can tell. The arrows can't hit him from the height of it, right? Even though the text says the arrows didn't hit him because of the spear, not because of how high it was. He also jumps off that wall, and if he jumped off the wall in the picture, I think he'd break something. So when they talk about, at least in the early fortifications, right, what are they? They're heaps of earth, right? They're not building massive stone walls, right? We have to read the text. When Sorensen looked, and this is 1988, so it's, the research is dated even more, has come out, but all confirmatory. He looked at 34 regions in Mesoamerica, surveyed them within 10 chronological periods as far back as early pre-classic. Of the 375 fortified sites documented, some 200 had definite defensive features, while 100 were listed as possibly fortified. So here's a picture of his text. So early pre-classic, only one possible fortification, right? That's pre-1000 BC. Early middle pre-classic, two possible. You start getting to late middle pre-classic, and you'll see the definite fortifications growing extensively. So in the late pre-classic and proto-classic periods, corresponding to the times in the books of Mosiah, Alma, and Helaman, at least 56 Mesoamerican archaeological sites were fortified. As of 1988. So what's our conclusion? Archaeology confirms the textual description of fortifications at the right time and the right place, generally speaking. The question now is, can we get even more specific? And this is really interesting. So first at Camino Hoyu, remember I mentioned this when we were talking about the issues of archaeology and even finding warfare. But it took them until the 1990s before they found a 164-foot segment of what they termed the Great Wall. It dates back to perhaps the first civilized period there, 500 BC. It had been built by piled up soil 22 feet high. So recall when the Zenophites returned to the city of Nephi, they, quote, began to repair the walls of the city, right? That type of wall would have been subject to erosion by regular rains and required systematic maintenance, right? So the textual description of them having to repair the wall makes perfect sense. Now let's get more specific. We're going to read a couple of descriptions of very specific fortifications that we get. The Nephites had dug up a ridge of earth round about them, which was so high that the Lamanites could not cast their stones and their arrows at them that they might take effect, because of the highness of the bank which had been thrown up, and the depth of the ditch which had been dug round about. Now when the Lamanites found they could not obtain power over the Nephites by the pass or the entrance, they began to try and dig down the banks of earth that they might obtain a pass to the enemies, right? So they're trying to dig down this big bank. But they were swept off by the stones and arrows. Here's arrows, right, that were thrown at them, right? So they're taking them off this bank. Here's another description, Alma 53, very similar. We're going to get even more specific now, though. When they built a breastwork of timbers upon the inner bank of the ditch. And they cast up the dirt out of the ditch against the breastwork of timbers until they had encircled the city round about with a strong wall of timbers and earth to an exceeding height. Finally, in Alma 52 through 5, and upon the top of these ridges of earth, Chief Captain Moroni caused that there should be timbers, yea, works of timbers built up to the height of a man round about the cities, and upon those works of timbers there should be a frame of pickets built upon the timbers round about that they were strong and high. Furthermore, he caused towers to be erected that overlooked those works of pickets, and he caused places of security to be built upon those towers, that the stones and the arrows of Lamanites could not hurt them, and they were prepared that they could cast stones from the top thereof and slay him who should attempt to approach near the walls of the city. Very specific fortification details. When Cortez arrived, he described a fortification he saw in the Maya lowlands. This is much later, right? So it's not a direct time correlation. None of these things would you know, be preserved from that long ago. So we'll have to assume that fortifications continue. But listen to what he described. There is only one level entrance, the whole town being surrounded by a deep, dry moat, which is behind which is wooden palisade as high as a man's breast. Behind this palisade lies a wall of very heavy board, some 12 feet tall, with embrasures through which to shoot their arrows, right? So there's timbers behind the moat. The lookout posts rise another, lookout posts, towers, right, rise another 8 feet above the wall, which likewise has large towers with many stones to hurl down on the enemy. I can't think of a more accurate description of the thing, the exact thing that we read in Alma is what Cortez provides us. David Webster explains how the fortifications of Bicon must have functioned. Again, compared to what we read in the Book of Mormon, the steep angles of the inner ditch wall and parapet slope could not have been climbed without the aid of ladders. Right? They couldn't get up. An enemy force caught at the bottom of the ditch would have been at the mercy of the defenders, whose most effective weapons under the circumstances would have been large rocks. To throw uphill from the outside is almost impossible. Defenders could have rained long-distance missiles on approaching enemies using spear throwers and slings. Right? So, conclusion. Assuming fortification technology remained consistent, we have specific and detailed correlation with the fortifications that we read about in the Book of Mormon and those found in the right place, at least in Mesoamerica. So, our overall conclusion on warfare. Despite the fact that Joseph Smith lived in the age of modern or technical warfare, we talked about that at the very beginning, how this huge shift in warfare occurs, both the 16th century and the Napoleonic Wars. So Joseph Smith is living post-shift. The Book of Mormon itself consistently reflects the basic patterns of pre-modern warfare as well as ancient Mesoamerican warfare. The pre-modern and Mesoamerican military patterns described in the Book of Mormon are not limited generalities, but extend to the minutest details of the text. We've covered just the following. Causes of warfare, if you remember, the agricultural economic base, the problems of supplying soldiers in times of war. We covered seasonal patterns in warfare. We covered military implications of geography and climate. We worked through actually two distinct battles, right, and showed them on the map. Limited use of animal resources, and then we covered weapons technology and typology and fortifications. We did not cover, but if you are interested, our primary sources cover even more congruence, community bases of military loyalty, tribal military organization, military innovation, social and economic impact, military implications of changing demographic patterns, recruitments based on tribes and communities, complex pre-battle maneuvering, extensive scouting and spying, pre-battle war councils, use of banners for mobilization and organization, patterns of flight after battle, the importance of oaths and loyalty and surrender, norms of international relations, treatment of robbers, laws of war, importance of plunder, guerrilla warfare, ritual destruction of cities, and ritual capture of kings. Actually, we're going to get into that today. On and on. So, again, we didn't cover a lot, but we covered just these two in the last two sections, and we get both general and specific correspondences. In none of these topics does the Book of Mormon contradict the ancient patterns of the or the practice of warfare. In many of these topics, the Book of Mormon uniquely reflects its heritage of Mesoamerica. Hugh Nibley called the study of military affairs in the Book of Mormon a, quote, rigorous test to the historical claims of the book, and our conclusion is that it passes that test. All right. So, most of right, the Book of Mormon, as we talked about, is written for this specific purpose and from this specific point of view, the Nephite point of view, and more specifically Mormon's point of view, right? And Nephi's for the small plates. They're getting across what they want to get across. So when we say glimpses of Lamanite culture, the point is that they're not giving us a treatise of the surrounding culture. We have to glean Lamanite culture from the stories that the Nephites are telling us. So we're going to do that in a couple of different instances here. The first thing that we're going to talk about is clues to culture in Benjamin's speech. So you remember King Benjamin, he begins his famous discourse with what looks like is an unusual set of introductory statements. So let's read those. I have not commanded you to come up hither, that ye should fear me, or that ye should think that I of myself am more than a mortal man. But I am like yourself, subject to all manner of infirmities in body and mind. Yet I have been chosen by this people and consecrated by my father, and was suffered by the hand of the Lord that I should be a ruler and a king over this people, and have been kept and preserved by his matchless power to serve you with all the might, mind, and strength which the Lord hath granted unto me. I say unto you that as I have been suffered to spend my days in your service, even up to this time, and have not sought for gold, nor silver, nor any manner of riches of you, neither have I suffered that you should be confined in dungeons, nor that you should make slaves one of another, nor that you should murder, plunder, or steal, or commit adultery, nor even have I suffered that you should commit any manner of wickedness, and have taught you that you should keep the commands of the Lord in all things which he hath commanded you. Right? So this is his introductory language to his speech. What is he doing here? Benjamin is setting up an implicit contrast between what he was and what his people would have known from cultural experience he could have been. Right? Benjamin wasn't, but could have been, like all the kings in non-Nephite cities that his people were clearly aware of, right? So he's telling him what he's not. So this is setting up this contrast to what other kings were. So let's walk through them. Myself, he spends a lot of time getting this point that I'm a human, right? I myself am not more than a mortal man. This is exactly the idea of Maya kingship that we understand. Maya kings were deified. Altar Q from Copan depicts Apollo's first 16 kings, each seated upon throne-like renditions of their respective name glyphs. Its central theme shows a literal passing of the torch from the founding king of Copan to the 16th ruler. While the first king may or may not have been considered divine in his own lifetime, he was clearly apotheosized as the sun god after his death. Claiming descent from a deified ancestor reinforces the divinity of the living king. Right? So Benjamin is setting up this clear contrast between every other king in the surrounding area, which was claiming divinity, and himself. I'm a mortal man. I suffer from the same infirmities, right? I am not divine. Nor has he sought gold, nor silver, nor any manner of riches of you. As we've talked about before, Mesoamerican societies by this point were hierarchically ranked, with kings at the apex of a system of increased wealth and power as one reached higher levels in the social hierarchy. Right, but what is Benjamin doing? He's sticking to that Nephite egalitarian ideal that we discuss when the founding document that Nephi first lays out, and Jacob through his speech, we covered that a few sessions ago. The Nephite egalitarian ideal, Benjamin's saying, I'm still sticking to that. Right, I'm not seeking to be supported by the people. He's not suffered that he should be confined in dungeons or make slaves. It's well known that both Mayan and later Aztecs practice slavery. Benjamin is showing that he is an enlightened administration, right? We don't do these things, practice slavery that the outside world is doing. Not suffer that you should murder, plunder, steal, or commit adultery. We're going to talk about the Mesoamerican cult of war, which was becoming dominant in this area, but it was typified by the tribute system. We talked about that, right? Where if you went and conquered an area, you'd get tribute from them. Human sacrifice. Which probably relates to this murder and the acquisition of goods through acts of war or raids. So he's saying, again, we aren't partaking in that cult of war, the religion of war that surrounds us. What's our conclusion? The introduction Benjamin gives to his sermon outlines concerns that are fully at home in a Mesoamerican context. They make sense as denials only against the common understanding that such practices were typical of other kings in other cities. Right? We talked about how the hardest thing about a text is understanding the cultural assumptions that are coming with that text that are unstated. These are cultural assumptions that are unstated in the text because everyone understood them. And that's why it makes sense only when we understand those unstated assumptions. All right, now we're going to move to overkingship and interstate visits, and with a brief detour into the word chariots, which has caused heartburn amongst critics of the Book of Mormon. So we read in Mosiah 24:2, the Lamanites had taken possession over all these lands. Therefore, the king of the Lamanites had appointed kings over all of these lands. It's kind of an odd thing to do, but the king of the Lamanites, he had appointed kings over all these lands. This is from Simon Martin and Nikolai Grub, The Chronicle of the Maya Kings and Queens. The emergence of new information from the inscriptions in which the Maya directly describe their political world allows a reassessment of the topic. Our own research points to a pervasive and enduring system of overkingship, that's what they call it, that shaped almost every facet of the classic landscape. Such a scheme accords closely with the wider Mesoamerican practice, while seeming to reconcile the most compelling features of the two existing views, namely the overwhelming evidence for multiple small kingdoms and the great disparities in the size of their capitals. So this idea of a king and then under kings with an over king is exactly what they're finding in the data. Remember Linda Sheely, we've quoted a lot from her as a scholar, and Peter Matthews. Our present view of the classic Maya lowlands is one of many small political units, each ruled over by a king, of Ahua status, who had under him various other Ahuas and Kahals. Ahua is a royal lord, Kahal is a provincial governor, some of whom were in charge of subsidiary centers within the polity. So again, scholars finding the same thing, over kingship and under kingship. We get even more specific details, though, about the relationship between how these kings interacted, these over-kings and under-kings, however you want to call them. After Ammon has earned King Lamoni's trust, right, Lamoni suggests the way to free Ammon's brethren from imprisonment in the land of Madoni. What does he say? Now, Lamoni said unto Ammon, I will go with thee to the land of Madoni, for the king of the land, whose name is Antiomno, is a friend unto me. Therefore, I will go to the land, that I may flatter the king of the land, and he will cast thy brethren out of prison. All right, so what is he suggesting here? He says he's friends with this other king. He's discussing a peaceful state visit. He's not saying, let's go to war, let's have a raid. He's going to go and he's going to flatter a king who is a friend unto me. As they're going, they meet the father of Lamoni. Remember that? And he's pretty angry. Why did you not come to the feast on that great day which I made a feast unto my sons and unto my people? And he also said, whither art thou going with this Nephite who is one of the children of a liar? And it came to pass that Lamoni rehearsed unto him whither he was going, for he feared to offend him. And he also told him all the cause of his tearing his own kingdom, that he did not go unto his father to the feast which he had prepared. The father's angry reaction makes it plain that Lamoni's absence was a serious breach of etiquette, and it might have been the reason that Lamoni's father was on the trail, maybe like hunting down his son. It could have caused an outbreak of war if not approached properly. From Sheely and Matthews, again, royal visits and other interstate relationships. The term royal visit may be defined as the peaceful visit of one lord to the city of another. Although instances of royal visits were only sporadically recorded, they were no doubt a common occurrence among the classic Maya. All right, so this idea of visiting on this formal, peaceful state visit fits comfortably there. All facets of the story, the formal visit to another city, the expectation of a king's obeisance to the overking, and having to explain why he was missing the feast. It's in the context of this story that we get mention of a chariot, right? Because, as you recall, when Ammon, he goes to feed the horses, right? And they're preparing the horses and the chariots. Why? Probably to go to the great feast appointed at land of Nephi by the father of Lamoni, who was the king over all land. That was the reason to prepare Lamoni's quote-unquote horses and chariot for travel. We already discussed how I think most scholars believe that horses is a mistranslation of some other animal. And we're going to talk about chariot for travel. This has been, you know, attacked as we think of chariot, we think of battle chariots in the Old Testament, you know, Ben-Hur and whatnot, right? But how are chariots, again, looking at the text, we have to look at how chariots are used in the Book of Mormon. Are just like horses, right? Is the Book of Mormon describing a horse culture? Well, that would be a big problem, but we decided that it wasn't describing horse culture. It only mentions them very specifically in these formal state visits. So just like horses, chariots are never used in battle in the Book of Mormon. Horses never actually pull chariots, right? Both are used for formal state visits, like the one we're describing now. So the Book of Mormon chariot does not need to suggest an old world war chariot. In fact, the Webster's 1828 dictionary indicates that one meaning for chariot was a half coach, a carriage with four wheels. Right, this is how it's actually used in Doctrine and Covenants as well. The Hebrew word in the KJV, meaning litter or sedan chair, is translated as chariot in the KJV. So we have examples where that doesn't mean old world war chariots. This was a non-wheeled vehicle wherein a rider was carried by servants. So clearly we are talking about a conveyance of some sort, right? We prepare the chariot. Maya kings were born in litters, often made of simple rushes and carried by just two bearers. Lintel 2 of Temple 1 shows a king wearing the balloon headdress of, we'll pronounce that, warfare adopted at the time of the Waxahachie conquest, and holding a bunch of javelins and shield. The original metaphors for war imported from the Teotihuacan. He sits in majesty on the litter that carried him into battle, right? While above him hulks the great war serpent. So we have lots of depictions of these litters. On the second litter, an enormous jaguar menaces the same pose. Oftentimes, these litters are associated with animals that aren't pulling, right, the litter. The humans are carrying the litter. The animals are depicted either underneath or on a separate litter themselves, as the jaguar is here. Graffiti drawings scratched on the walls of Tikal palaces depict the conjuring of supernatural beings from the other world. Several of these elaborate doodles show the great litters of the king. These litters were used for royal processions and nobles or dignitaries making a political visit. For instance, in 1542, after the Spanish conquest of the Maya region, quote, a throng of warriors escorting a young Maya lord seated in a palanquin or litter approached some Spanish sentries, made signs that he had come in peace and that he had brought food in what was apparently a diplomatic visit. Here's one such representation. Here's an animal underneath. Here's the litter, and they're carrying the lord or the king. Earliest known depiction of a Mesoamerican litter is at Izapostela 21, which is dated to around 300 to 50 BC. So the suggestion that of many scholars, just like the horse, that there was something on the plate text that Joseph, there's something on that plate text that Joseph put in horse and chariot for. We don't find any evidence for, not clear evidence for horses, and horses are never used in the manner that horse-like people use them. So the idea is, what was on that plate text? The suggestion is that the chariot was some sort of conveyance, a litter that would be carried, and it was associated with some sort of animal that was used in formal state visits, and so it fits the textual descriptions much better than what we would think of as an old world war chariot. So we kind of made a detour there, but the conclusion in terms of overkingship and interstate visits is that in both general organization of overkingships and specific types of king-to-king relationships, the Book of Mormon correlates with known Mesoamerican culture. All right.
Oh. The big concern about chariots is there's just never been any like archaeological evidence of these old war types of chariots.
Certainly, yeah. So right, you know, carried by horses. We find small figurines that have four wheels, and you know, you could call it, but it was looked like a toy.
Mm-hmm.
So the big debate archaeologically is, did they have the wheel? Well, at least in the toy, they had the wheel, but there's no evidence that they used wheeled conveyances, and most likely because it wasn't useful to them in the geography that they were dealing with. But there's still debate. did they actually have wheeled technology? But yes, that's the, so the concern again is that it's anachronistic in terms of place, that if you're thinking of an old world war chariot, that we don't find them, and you know, and so what, you know, what's going on? And the response is, well, you got to look at it in the text, and we have ample room for the fact that Joseph could have mistranslated. He was always improving the text. We went through the process of translation first for this very specific purpose. So we're not coming from this idea of a literal translation where every word is given to him by God and matches the word on the plate text, right? We've talked about it being a functional translation. Functional translation, we have a weird words in there. We have nias, right, which isn't translated. We have just weird things that show up in the text because it's a, you know, part of Joseph was intimately involved with the process of translator. And if he's not aware of those words, you know, and he translates them, he mistakes what's going on. All right, so treatment of important captives. Lamanite's royal visit to Antimonio finds Ammon's captive brethren. Right, they get a far worse reception than Ammon, right? Ammon, like, Lamanite's like, first try and you can marry my daughter, and then, all right, then you can go out and defend me. But when Ammon did meet with them, with his brethren, he was exceedingly sorrowful. For behold, they were naked, and their skins were worn exceedingly because of being bound with strong cords. They had also suffered from hunger, thirst, and all kinds of afflictions. Nevertheless, they were patient in all their sufferings. From, again, Sheely and David Friedel. Prestigious captives taken in battle were often kept alive for years on end. They were displayed in public rituals and often participated in these rituals in gruesome, humiliating, and painful ways. As depicted, one such ill-fated captive is nearly naked, stripped of all his marks of rank and prestige, holding his bound wrists up toward the magnificently dressed 14-year-old king. So they had a clear pattern of mistreating of prisoners. A polychrome Maya vase from the early classic period shows a captive dancing. The dancer's face is swollen, apparently as a result of the torture. Victims were beaten, mutilated, their fingernails torn out, and they were subjected to prolonged bouts of bloodletting before eventually being killed. We're going to get to this, but the Maya cult of war, religion of war, viewed blood as a part of creation. And so king's blood, the king would actually bloodlet a little bit in ritual, but there would be a lot of bloodletting of the captives as well. So it was linked with creation itself. That's why they were doing this. So let's get a little bit more into the cult of war. And to do that, we're going to talk about the anti-Nephi Lehis. We talked about their swords being stained with blood, their wood swords being stained with blood. So we know the story. Ammon converts Lamanite's father. We don't know his name. He's just Lamanite's father. He crowns one of his sons, whose original name we don't know, but he renames himself upon assuming the throne of Anti-Nephi Lehis, right? And then he makes this announcement. Now behold, my brethren, since it has been all that we could do, as we were the most lost of all mankind, to repent of all of our sins and the many murders which we have committed, and to get God to take them away from our hearts, for it was all we could do to repent sufficiently before God that he would take away our stain. Now, my best beloved brethren, since God hath taken away our stains, and our swords have become bright, let us stain our swords no more with the blood of our brethren. Behold, I say unto you, nay, let us retain our swords, that they may not be stained with the blood of our brethren. For perhaps, if we should stain our swords again, they can no more be washed bright through the blood of the Son of our great God, which shall be shed for the atonement of our sins. From Drew, The Lost Chronicles of Maya Kings, the aim of Maya warfare, in part, was to capture prominent individuals from an enemy state, put them to torture, and finally to sacrifice them, normally by beheading. Talked a little bit about the blood. For the Maya, blood was the conduit for, quote, the inner solar spirit. Sacrificial bloodletting became both nourishment and worship for the gods, and the substitute sacrifice that renews creation, right? It was sacred. Shedding of blood was sacred. It was nourishment and worship for their gods, and it substitutes sacrifice that renews creation. From Dennis Tedlock, Creation of the Popol Vuh, the creation was accomplished in part through sacrifice, right? So it's the very way that the the earth, the cosmos was made. So think about that now in the context of his speech. Why are they the most lost of all mankind? Why does he say that? Their previous religion, think about the turn these people took, right? Their previous religion glorified warfare. It saw bloodshed as a religious act, and it exalted torture and human sacrifice. Right? So these people had moved from a worldview in which the very existence of the world depended on shedding the blood of sacrificial victims. And now they've adopted a worldview where the only sacrifice that matters is the Savior's coming sacrifice. Right? So they were the most lost of all mankind. I think, again, looking in context of this cult of war that they had given up to embrace the gospel. So why did they then take their swords, all the weapons which they were used for the shedding of man's blood, and they buried them deep in the earth? Oftentimes in what are called terminal actions, there would be this burial. So terminal actions, although difficult to separate in all instances and often embedded in dedication events, generally include the defacement, mutilation, and breaking, burning, or alteration of portable objects. So this is pottery, jade, or stone tools, sculptures, stelae, or buildings. They may involve the raising and burial of a monumental structure before a new construction. Based on the date of these actions as metaphors for sacrifice, often occurred at a period endings, such as termination of a calendaric period or ritual cycle. So he's entering a new oath, right? A new ritual cycle with his people. And as part of that, they have a ritualistic bearing of those weapons, right? Some people have suggested it was a bearing of the hatchet, or that some sort of such metaphor, which doesn't work, right? Bearing of the hatchet is about peace. You bury the hatchet amongst warring factions. Others have suggested, right, that anti-Nephi Lehi's became pacifists, but that's also not true, right? Because who are they fine sending to war?
Their sons,
right, who were pre-oath, right? So they weren't pacifists in the sense that they were opposed to war in general. They were opposed to them taking part of it because they had come from this background where it was their religion. It was glorified and it was sacred, and I think they were just so concerned with falling back into that, right? So they weren't pacifists as we understand the term.
They were also honoring their oath that they had made.
Right. Right, and that oath was, like, I think, so important to them because of, like I said, the gravity of where they'd come from. It wasn't a matter of, you know, they were fighting just to fight, right, as part of, it was their religions, right? So they were, it made a clean break with their old religion. This is really interesting. Again, continuing with the story doesn't make a lot of sense read out of historical context, so let's keep reading the story. So, if you recall, the brethren, the Lamanites, why were they coming to the anti-Nephi-Lephites? They made preparations for war. They came up to the land of Nephi for the purpose of destroying the king and to place another in his stead, right? So they have a very specific goal when they go to fight these guys. They want to take away the king and install a new king. How was this done? First, they didn't meet any resistance, right? They just slayed 1,005 of them. Now, among those who joined the people of the Lord... I put this in here just because I thought it was interesting. We talked about textual evidence that there were people, that the quote-unquote Lamanites was a term for other people, not just a patrol term. Notice that they make a point to say, but they were actual descendants of Laman and Lemuel, right? So it's rare, I think, that you're actually seeing actual descendants of Laman and Lemuel. Most of the time you're just seeing other people. But in the text here we read that a few were actual descendants of Laman and Lemuel. So regardless of, some people join the church, right, out of, it's crazy these people are laying down. But what did the others do? The others took their armies, and they went over into the borders of the land of Zarahemla, and fell upon the people in the land of Ammonihah and destroyed them. Recall that we talked about the destruction of Ammonihah in the context of geography. And remember, they came on the borders of the coast, and they came in the incursion. This is kind of an odd thing to do, right? They're trying to dispose this king. They apparently do it with no resistance. And they kill 1,000 people. But then they go in and they go attack Ammonihah. It doesn't make a lot of sense. They've accomplished their goal. Why do they got to go kill a bunch of people in Ammonihah? Here's the reason. From Simon Martin, and again, Nicole Grube, we've already quoted from the Chronicle of the Mighty Kings and Queens. The monuments that... Again, I won't say his name. This king erected here proved especially influential and were emulated the city for the next 150 years. His stela 25 established an inaugural motif showing the newly installed king seated high on a decorated scaffold or litter. The seat itself was reached by a ladder draped with a cloth marked by the king's bloody footprints, the contribution of a sacrificial victim slain at its base. Again, from Shili and Miller, The Blood of Kings. The image on the lead-in plaque refers to a second event that is vital to the process of ascension. Ascension is the rise of a new king, right? A captive who is to be sacrificed as a blood offering, sanctifying the transformation of the new king, lies bound and prostrate at his feet. The captive marked as a noble is marked as a noble, and was taken in battle specifically to serve in this ritual. Unhappy with his fate, he lifts his bound wrists and kicks his feet, twisting his body to look back across his shoulder, perhaps hoping for a reprieve. Other representations of ascension ceremonies confirm that ritual sacrifice was a regular and necessary part of the process sanctifying the new ruler. What did they have to do to install a new king? They had to capture someone in battle to sacrifice them. But the anti-Nephites, right, they weren't cooperating. So the attacking Lamanites have already dethroned Lamoni's brother, must install a new king. For this particular ritual, they needed sacrificial victims who have been taken in battle. The anti-Nephi-Lehis have denied them the right kind of captives. Hence, the Lamanites have to find someone who will actually fight back. Right? Which is the reason they go to Ammonihah. So what do? They had destroyed the people in the city of Ammonihah and also some of the around the borders and taken others captive into the wilderness. Right? It specifically mentions the captives taken back in the wilderness, which are rescued, which we talked about last time, through the Nephite intervention. This is the only instance where Lamanite invasion emphasizes that it transported its captives with the army back to its home. It made no attempt to enforce a client or tribute relationship with Ammonihah, right? Lots of times that's the reason for war, to establish its tribute relationship. Indeed, such an effort would have been virtually impossible given Ammonihah's location deep in Nephite territory. This war only has one real purpose, the taking of captives. Right? So they go around to a soft spot, destroy and take some captives because they need to install their new king. As M. Catherine Brown and James Garber note, evidence suggests that raiding for the purpose of capturing sacrificial victims was quite common and had strong ritual components. That's what I'm suggesting, and scholars are suggesting happened in this particular instance. There's a reason they went to Ammonihah. Stripped of its cultural context, the story of the anti-Nephi-Lehis still inspires, right? We've used it as inspiring for many years, but it doesn't make historical sense. With that context restored from a Mesoamerican perspective, all of the aspects of the record become not only understandable, but many of them were inevitable. This is one of the stories where the context significantly improves the reading of the text. And these are the type of correspondences and correlations that we are really interested in, where culture, geography, helps us enlighten the text. It doesn't just say we dug up this thing. That's where, fortifications and warfare are more of the type of, a strict correspondence from text to something we've dug up. These cultural, I think, are much more important and help us understand the book better. And that is it. We're 15 minutes early tonight. Any questions? We're going to try and finish Book of Mormon. Hopefully in the next one or two, we're going to go through some of the things that we need to get rid of in terms of quote-unquote evidences, like if we've heard of the Tree of Life, Stella. Maybe we've heard of that. We're going to talk about why that is not appropriate to use as a evidence for the Book of Mormon, as well as Quetzalcoatl and Jesus Christ. Why there are some things that as a culture we've latched onto early in our history that we need to move away from because they don't pan out upon further investigation. And then we'll move into the terminal period of the Book of Mormon. Gadiant and robbers, the land northward, really interesting with the rise of a city called Teotihuacan, which becomes a dominant force in the region and really helps explain the Nephite final demise. Why did it turn from a situation where they would create tributes, sometimes get sacrificial victims, to total annihilation? Why did it make that turn? And the cultural of, and history of the place can really help us understand that. So we'll try and finish the. We'll also talk about the Christ's death and the happenings in the New World, and talk about some of the correspondences to some of the natural phenomena that were could have been occurring at that time and place. And then we'll wrap up and we'll move to the positive case, continue the positive case for LDS truth claims, looking at Book of Abraham, and then into some of the temple and rituals that we perform that have ancient origins. So we're trying to move through all the, anyway, that's kind of the roadmap in terms of the positive case.
I have a question.
Yeah.
What's Stella whatever number mean?
Oh, so Estella is like, we showed that, like a rock carving.
Oh, okay.
Right, so when...
so you're referring to specific ones.
Yeah, specific ones. So that we showed one of them here of Kamina Helyu that shows the curved blade. There's a famous one, a fairly famous one, and that comes from further south in South America that seems to look like a tree. And some LDS... people have written that it's a correspondence to Lehi's tree of life, and it's been used in that context. We'll talk about why that's inappropriate in the same way that just doesn't work. So we want to make sure that we're accurate, right? And when you move away from, you know, I think early on it was like anything that came out, you know, we'd look in and we'd match and try and match. And I think the scholarship is moving in a great direction where. We're maintaining as much accuracy as we can and not jumping to conclusions. And the book is proving more and more historic and prescient than did in 1830, than did in 1950, than did in 2000. So, but the scholarship is going a better way too. So we just want to make sure we're doing things not, you know, taking things out of context. Cool. That's it.
Thank you.